In Christianity, it sets up against the sermon, which insists on what must be done by one who would become holy, a vision of the cosmos which is holy through its beauty. It makes men participate naturally and almost involuntarily in the world of holiness. And that is the Titus Burckhardt, the great author of this remark, who died some 12 years ago, and whom I considered as one of my closest friends, is referring here to the sermon of the preacher on the one hand, and the overwhelming beauty of the church or the cathedral, which is sacred art, which is done in the image of the cosmos, which is holy through its beauty. And it is that is connected with holiness. But art does not rely on didactic teaching like the sermon to gain its ultimate effect. Its function is not so much to define spiritual wisdom as to give us a taste of that wisdom, each according to his capacity. And Shakespeare's plays give us a taste of that wisdom according to... they're not bent on didactic teaching. It's the total effect. That is the taste in question. And it's amazing how play after play of Shakespeare overwhelms us with this taste, which we cannot define and which gets forgotten, of course, but if it's repeated over and over again, and if one adds to it, of course, sacred rites which are performed, esoteric rites which are performed with a view to the same purification, then it is not forgotten, it is not lost. We enter in with Shakespeare to this extraordinary beauty which he himself had conceived, the harmony of the universe. And that's what Keats thought of Shakespeare.
I wanted to quote something just before this comment in your book. You had said that Milton had tried to justify the way of God in his writing, but and you say Hilton may have known this in theory, but in practice he was a son of the Renaissance and very deeply under the spell of humanism. Then you go on to say, Now Shakespeare also seeks to justify the ways of God to man. That is beyond doubt the essence of his purpose in writing, but his justifications on that intellectual plane where alone it is possible. And this brings us back to the theme of his plays, for the intellect is none other than that lost faculty of vision that is symbolized by the Holy Grail and the elixir of life.
Yes.
I found that statement so beautiful, so moving, and your reference to the plays, I found in reading the sonnets, because I came to Shakespeare from that way, that very much peace, joy just in reading that. We're going to find that citation from Keats, but I wanted to say that what Emerson said of Shakespeare, Shakespeare is as much out of the crowd as he is out of the category of eminent authors. He is inconceivably wise, the others conceivably. Emerson, such a great fan.
Well, I would certainly, I'm delighted to hear that Emerson says. And of course, as regards the sonnets, it's not possible that they should not have expressed something which dominated Shakespeare's life, as we see from the plays, this wisdom, this sense of the harmony of the universe. They were written, the sonnets that we have, they were written in the 90s, before the great plays were written, but it's not possible that Shakespeare's greatness was not maturing during the age of the sonnets. The sonnets must be dominated by the wisdom that Shakespeare was growing up and maturing in Shakespeare.
The first mention.
And it was very interesting to me to find that someone else had discovered through the sonnets, alone through the sonnets, what I had discovered through the plays. It was of great interest. But it is not possible that the sonnets could be separated from the plays as regards what lies behind them. They come from the same pen, from the same soul, from the same intelligence. Yes. And it's not possible that they were not dominated by the thoughts which dominate the plays.
When I was first given your book, I felt that same way, that you were writing on in the plays what I'd been looking at in the sonnets. I feel that same way. In your book, you mentioned that there was a meagerness of biographical knowledge of Shakespeare's life, and that he seems to have, quote, slipped through life so unobtrusively. And this fact, you state, may well be considered a characteristic feature of the particular greatness which your book claims for him. I would go on to ask, Shakespeare's company that he must have kept in his lifetime, one would think might have been with others who were spiritually inclined. And I wondered if that thought might have occurred to you, and if you considered who some of his company might have been in his life.
I haven't considered that question because I'm ignorant. I'm ignorant of the details, and I've not read books about Shakespeare. I know very little what the average person knows about Shakespeare's life. I don't know things that they know. I don't know, but I do know that he slipped through life unobtrusively, and relatively speaking, and I do know what's in the plays. I believe that Shakespeare was a truly great spiritual man. We shall never know. And I believe also that he must have been a member of some esoteric order which existed. Such orders did exist alongside of the church. Because authors were, but Shakespeare did not give us any hint about himself in his plays or in what he wrote that can be followed up. We shall never know what Shakespeare was spiritually speaking, but I can't help but feel he must have been a member of one of these orders of mysticism, yes, which existed and which no longer exists.
Yes.
But we shall never know, I think, the answer to that question.
Do you believe when he was writing that he was thinking who his audience would be and considered the idea that he was just trying to do his part to uplift the consciousness of those people who were going to come in contact with his plays and his works?
I don't... I mean, he was doing what... I don't think he necessarily felt that. He was under, very often under inspiration, but he had the main ideas of portraying. He was a dramatist, an amazing dramatist, and one finds, and amazingly concentrated, of course it has to be, drama has to be concentrated, but well, that's full of things in Shakespeare's plays that one doesn't notice until later on. For example, in Hamlet, there are the four meanings of Shakespeare, mentioned by Dante, the literal meaning, or the historical meaning, the allegorical meaning, the moral meaning, and the anagogical meaning, that is the esoteric or innermost meaning. Occasionally there are things which don't make sense except at the highest level. For example,
highest meaning the esoteric,
the anagogical or yes, esoteric meaning.
Yes.
For example, take Hamlet's speech when he fails to kill. You see, when Laertes, if he'd found the king praying, as Hamlet does, he comes into the scene, he finds the king kneeling at prayer, and he could, it's a wonderful opportunity to kill him. But Hamlet always finds arguments to put off this, what he needs to do. And he says, supposing I kill him now, he is praying. How does that revenge my father?
Mm.
He killed my father when he was asleep and not when he was praying. I kill the king when he is praying, perhaps to send him to paradise. All his sins will be forgiven. This isn't revenge. Let me wait till he is drunk or doing something which corresponds to his real nature. To send him to hell, he expresses, literally speaking, the desire to send Claudius to hell. Well, literally speaking, that is a monstrous idea because it doesn't make sense. It doesn't correspond to Hamlet's greatness of character that he has, because the king, Claudius, did not want to send his father to hell. He wanted the throne, but he didn't want to send King Hamlet, the old king,
mm-hmm,
to hell. Here is Hamlet wanting to send the soul to hell, a monstrous thing. That's the literal meaning. According to the allegorical meaning, it also doesn't make real sense, certainly not at the moral meaning, but it does make sense at the anagogical meaning, because what Claudius represents anagogically is the hold that the devil has upon the soul. And that a man can, and it represents, Claudius represents the hold that the devil has on Hamlet's soul, which prevents him from being something of him, you see, something of Hamlet himself, which he can send that to hell. That's part of his true character. So it's only at the highest sense that that remark of Hamlet, or that attitude of Hamlet, makes real sense. The literal meaning, it doesn't correspond to Hamlet's true nature, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But it does correspond to the higher meaning, the highest meaning of the play, that is, what has to be thrown off is the hold which Satan, that is Claudius who represents, the hold that he has, that Satan has over the soul, the human soul, that has to be thrown.
Are there any other authors you know of who have written about these deeper meanings, or other persons who've commented on them in Shakespeare's works?
Well, not on Shakespeare's works. Titus Burckhardt was in the same, I mean, he was one of Schumann's representatives, and he was his close friend at the same time. And his writings, we quoted the other day, I read out to you a quotation, which is in my book on Shakespeare, from Titus Burckhardt, about the sermon, the difference between the sermon that is preached and the church in which it is preached, that the sermon tells man what he must do. The church invites man to participate in the harmony of the universe, one might say, without any effort or spontaneously on his part, without demanding anything, just. But the answer to one of your questions, which is important, is the difference between younger people today in responsiveness to my book and older people who are less interested, because there was first of all humanism, which meant that was the end of the Middle Ages. Humanism meant the reason becoming the dominant faculty. Mm-hmm. Everything needed to be proved. The word intellect was dragged down, as I said, to a lower level, because it's people don't cease to be, with all the changes, man doesn't cease to have a certain tendency towards hypocrisy. And the older words, which had their precise meaning in the Middle Ages, are dragged down. They're retained because they're impressive, intellectual. I gave an example of saying that a certain person is one of the leading intellectuals of our day. And yet he may be, one of the most anti-intellectuals of our day, according to the true meaning of intellectual, as it was understood in the Middle Ages, that is, a faculty which is only concerned with things of the next world. People today tend... Then there was the Enlightenment in the 18th century, after, when people began to think that they had reached the summit of enlightenment over the past, that in Europe, in Western Europe especially, that man had become enlightened at last to a very considerable degree. And then came, in the last century, Darwin and the idea of evolution. Mm-hmm. And most teachers today in the schools, they don't believe in religion. Even in official schools where students have to go to chapel twice every Sunday, this still exists. In my school, it's still the case that the boys, and it's now co-educational, they have to go to chapel twice on Sundays, three times in weekdays, and the other 3 days of the week they have communal prayers. And but religion stands a little chance of success in the teaching. When I was at school, we had one or two teachers who did believe in religion. I remember this, I should have mentioned it to you yesterday, in considering my how I came, first of all, to understand these things. I remember once at school, we were reading the Plato's so-called Republic, but I remember the master who was teaching us putting down the book. We were reading it in Greek and, of course, struggling with grammar and syntax and that sort of thing, but he put down his book on his desk and he said, "I think I should tell you boys that what we are reading now is one of the very greatest things that have ever been written." And it was the chapter on the prisoners in the cave. Men were likened to prisoners in a cave, by Plato. And they were looking at shadows cast on the wall in front of them, which they took to be the supreme reality. And then Plato recounts how one man manages to escape from the cave, and he goes up to the world and sees the sun and the moon and the trees and everything as it is. And he comes down to tell the prisoners his experiences, and they look on him as a madman, and they say, "But this is invention, it's not true." But some of them believe, and they want to escape too. And they see that what they're looking at is just shadows of shadows, which is very true. And that remark of the master was teaching, made a great impression on me.
And take a look at that Ancient Beliefs and Modern Superstitions by Martin Lings.
I wrote this to help to, in 1921, Reinke wrote, "The only statement consistent with her dignity that science can make with regard to this question is to say that she knows nothing about the origin of man. Today, this statement is as true as it was when Reinke made it. And then this man, Douglas Dewar, who's written a great deal about this question from a purely scientific point of view. He was a great ornithologist himself, but he writes altogether scientific things, and he says, no evolutionist who values his reputation will name any known fossil and say that while not human, it is an ancestor of Homo sapiens. No evolutionist who values his reputation. It is. And there have been other books written showing that the evolutionists themselves are at war with each other in all their claims, sort of one fighting against another. And it's pure invention, because the creation of the world is something miraculous, and that's not tolerated by modern science. The idea that God should... the Hindus speak not of creation, but manifestation. It is a manifestation of... the world is a manifestation of God. As it was created, man was made in the image of God, as we know from the book of Genesis. And this remains, this hasn't changed. But the average teacher, you see, is behind the times. Yeah. They've been brought up on evolution. I was brought up on evolution. I mean, all the masters at my school believed in evolution, but we had to, we nonetheless read the Old Testament on Sundays, and which contradicted everything that we were taught during the week. It was and today things are, the teachers are not interested in the inner meaning of Shakespeare. They don't want to see it. It's obvious, but young people do. They're very receptive. And I told you about these Elizabethan weekends that we had. My lecture was very well received by the students on Shakespeare. I could see, they were spellbound, I could see.
These were at St. Albans area?
Yes, it was it was near St. Albans.
When you mentioned young people and... two people come to mind. One is the Nobel laureate poet Rabindranath Tagore, who, being unhappy with the schools in India, started his own schools and used his Nobel Prize money. But one comment that he had made is, he said, learning is not something that you pump in and cram in. What it is supposed to do is you take the person or the student, and really it awakens the knowing already inside, and awakens that, so that what one is doing is opening his own faculty of understanding, and that makes learning more exciting, when it feels like, ah, yes, now I understand, but not because someone had pumped it in, so to speak, from without.
Yes, but when what is taught, actually, whether it's pumped in or not, if it is false,
oh yes,
then it, that's what happens today, then it doesn't awaken inner learning. But there is something in man that is incorruptible, and that is the heart, which is buried which is known as the heart, that is the center of the soul. It is buried. They were conscious of it in the Middle Ages of its existence. Most people don't, the vast majority of people, of course, have no access to it. But nonetheless, it's there. And everyone that is not knows, has a sense of things being wrong. In the modern world, no men are totally deceived, but they've become like houses divided against themselves. There's something in man who feels that the modern perspective is wrong. More or less clearly, there's a lot of difference of degree, and very few people are entirely satisfied with the modern outlook. But there's nothing they can do about it, and that's the fault of education. You see, modern education is based largely on two things. First of all, Copernicus, which the discovery that the Earth moves round the Sun instead of the other way round. Well, that is not really a rediscovery, because there is a good deal of evidence that many of the ancients knew that fact. But what we see, I doubt if people will ever cease to speak of sunrise and sunset. They still do that, despite the knowledge that it's an error, because it's not an error in the sense that it's what we perceive. We perceive the sun moving round the earth, and that means that in a certain sense it does say, because the whole of this world is an illusion, really, from the supreme point of view. It is a manifestation of God, which will go back to God. But it's not a reality. God himself is the sole reality.
Is that something of what Prospero means when he said, we are such stuff as dreams are made on?
Yes, precisely. That is, of course, I comment on that in the chapter on the Tempest.
Young people who are interested in filling that void, who feel there's something amiss, is there some way that the question is, how can one's capacity or interest in one's spiritual growth be awakened by Shakespeare? And should this awakening be attempted at all in teaching or performing of the works?
I said that in the performing of the works, one has only to, the best one can do is to be as true as possible to Shakespeare's text. I would like to give you an example of something. This has not got to do with the directly with this question. There's nothing one can do. One doesn't want, art doesn't preach. It's not the purpose of art to preach or to teach in a didactic way. The purpose of art is to reveal, to open doors. Now, in producing Shakespeare's plays, I noticed one thing. For example, in Hamlet, which is perhaps worth mentioning, Shakespeare was such a a remarkable dramatist. He, in every sense of drama, he seemed to have in him by nature. And he spellbinds the audience in all sorts of different ways without necessarily calculating that himself.
I want to read something from something in your book. You mentioned that in life people have subjective perceptions of what is near to them, and people's view of things is not close to them. A view of things not close to them are viewed with cold objectivity. Above all, we fail to see the pattern. By analogy, life is a great tapestry, and as if we looked at it from the wrong side, where the pattern is obscured by a maze of threads,
yes,
most of which seem to have no purpose. A Shakespeare play is like a much smaller piece of that tapestry, partly copied from life, but also in virtue of an aspect of what we call his secret, copied from the original of the other. That